Welcome back on our third video, third lesson. So we have made it so far, and I'm sure it will be a pleasure for you to continue with us. So today's video is going to be all about power factor, which I've been mentioning since the third video or the first video, but I'm going to explain it now, so you're going to understand it, what happened with it. So on the first point, it's all about the power factor. What is it? Phase diagram, how to draw it, and then as well active, reactive, and complex power, the three power. Power factor of an electrical power system is particularly important to power company and large industry because the power factor, it determines how efficiently the power distribution equipment is used. We know that most of the loads are inductive in nature. Most of the loads are inductive, and therefore have a lower lagging power factor. This low power factor causes an increase in current. As a result, additional losses of active power occur in all elements of the power. To assure the most favorable condition for a supply system, it's important to have a power factor as close as possible to unity. When a power factor is close to unity, it's like a pure resistor. Can you see? So the idea here is what? When you look, for instance, at a bigger motor, a motor is made up of coil. Those coil are conductor turned together, so to make a big conductor, a group of conductor. Okay, so when it comes to those motor, when you plug it to your supplier from your ESCOM, ESCOM is your supplier. Okay, when you plug that motor, if the power factor of that motor is low, when you start that motor, sometime you're gonna see in your house the light is going on and off at the beginning. What happened is that lower power factor require a lot of current when you start it, and then it goes stable. Can you see? So it require a lot of current, then it's going to affect your supplier. It's going to affect ESCOM. Okay, so we need a higher power factor equipment. Okay, the load with our power factor provides more power in desired form than an identical load with a lower power factor. The system with higher power factor is therefore more efficiency. Okay, so how do we calculate our power factor, which we say a power factor is really important? Why is it happening? Because we have more inductive load. Okay, so this is might affect our supplier. Okay, it require a lot of current. From the calculation, our power factor is given by cos of the angle. What is that angle? That angle is called to be the power factor angle, phase angle, impedance angle, complex power angle, or the load angle. But how do we calculate it? You can say the angle of the voltage minus the angle of the current. Okay, so that's how you calculate it. So let's have a look, for instance, when you have a capacitive load. A capacitive load, which means is a load where we have a resistor and a capacitor combined together, as discussed previously. When it comes to this load, we're gonna expect to have a power factor that will be leading. Leading why? Because our current will be leading. The current will come before the voltage. Okay? That's what it means, lagging. Okay? So how do we form this power factor leading? From our phasor diagram, we know that the pure resistance at zero, pure inductor capacitor at minus 90, and then you have that impedance. So how do you calculate that impedance? That is your equation when calculating the total impedance of a leading power factor. When it comes to an inductive load, a combination of a resistor and an inductor, the power factor is lagging. What is lagging mean? It means the current is coming behind our voltage. The current is coming behind the voltage. Okay, and therefore we know the pure resistance is always at the angle of zero, pure inductor at the angle of 90, and then you have our total impedance, and that you can see how to calculate our impedance when you have this combination. And then in the previous video, we have discussed already how to calculate the total impedance of the combination of the three. Okay, so one thing we observe is that there is a formation of an angle when you have a combination of the two. Can you see? We have this angle here. You have this angle here. So this angle is called to be an impedance angle. It's called to be all the name that I call it from the previous slides. Okay, so this angle is what it's called to be a power factor angle. Okay, because we have a capacitor and an inductor. The two components are reactive components. Reactive component to what? To the frequency. Okay, so if our capacitance is bigger, the bigger will be our power factor. If our capacitance is lower, the lower will be our power factor angle. If our inductor is bigger, the bigger will be what? Our power factor. But if it's smaller, the smaller will be our power factor angle. Okay, so that's how our system is affected by what? By this reactive component, a capacitor and an inductor. If they are big, the bigger we're gonna have our power factor angle. Okay, so we're gonna have a look on how to correct this problem of power factor in the second chapter. Okay, recall of power coordinate plane. This is our polar coordinate plane. If we are doing our, this is our coordinate plane. If we are reading our angle in a coordinate plane in a anticlockwise direction, what will happen? Reading it in a anticlockwise direction, it means we are going in this direction. So it starts from zero plus all the angles are going to be positive. Okay, but now if you are reading it in a clockwise direction, all the readings are going to be negative. Okay, because now you start it from zero minus 15. It's all about the way you read it. Okay, but an angle of minus 15 and an angle of 345 are similar. They are the same angle, but the way we read it, minus 150 was read in a clockwise direction, 345 was read in anticlockwise direction, but the two, they are a vector at the same position. You should be used to that. Okay, phasor diagram. How to do the phasor diagram? The first thing, we need to have a reference. Okay, and then when you talk about the reference, it's all about one of the two. The given voltage must have an angle because we are moving in a polar coordinate plane. If the voltage doesn't have the angle, which means the current, we're gonna have a specific angle. Okay, so we're gonna have a reference. It's like you want to go somewhere, or you have, they give you 2%. They want you to give the position of the other one. Okay, so first of all, in order for you to give the position to another one, you need to be able to know the position of 1%. Okay, so we're gonna take them in form of blue guy and red guy. So the red guy is gonna be our voltage. Okay, so in order for us to give the position to the blue guy, which is the current, we need to know first of all the position of one. Okay, so for instance, if they give us the voltage as the reference, okay, so this is a 1D plane and this is a 3D plane. So which means, let's say for instance, our voltage is at 10 degrees. So this voltage is at 10 degrees, as you see. And then you come here in the Cartesian plane, as we explained, 10 degrees can be somewhere there in a 2D dimension. Okay, so you know the position of one. That's why I say the reference is to know the position of one. You have two unknown, you must know the position of one first. It's always going to be given.
Okay, so that position can either be for the voltage or for the current, but you must know the position of one that you reference. Okay, and then the second thing we need is to know if it's leading or lagging. Leading or lagging, what does that mean? Already with leading, it's all about coming before lagging, it means behind, but it's all about the current. It's always this guy, the current, who is going to do what? To lead or to lag the voltage. Never the other way around. It's always about the current. The current can either lead or lag the current. Lead or lag. Okay? To lead is to come before. To lag is to come behind. Okay? And then the three things, as we said, we need to know the position. If we know the position of one person, and we know that the other person is either coming before or behind it, but in our time here we call it to be leading or lagging, and it's all about the guy, the current, who is going to lead or to lag the other guy. So as we see, the three things we need to know were our power factor angle. Our power factor angle is the split difference between the two, between the current and the voltage. Okay, so let's say for instance they come, they give us our power factor angle to be like 10. Okay, so now look what happened. First of all, we need to have a reference. We have draw our reference. Now they say the other guy is leading. Who's that guy? Is the current. So if you come here, we're gonna say the current is coming before the voltage. Okay, and then if you go in the 2D dimension, it's gonna be before the voltage, it's coming before the voltage. But what is the split difference between the two? The split difference between the two is that angle, which we say is gonna be 10. And then the split is gonna be how much? 10. Can you see? Okay, and therefore if you say 10 plus 10, so you're gonna say the current at which position? As 20. Can you see? Our guy, the current, it's gonna be at the angle of 20. So if you come here, the voltage at 10, the difference between the two is 10, then the current will be at 20. Can you see that? Okay, so let's try to do it with a lagging power factor. Okay, with a lagging power factor, let's say for instance our reference now is given as the current. Okay, and they say lagging, they give us our power factor at 15. How do we draw it? We come in our 1D dimension, we say the reference in this case is the current. The current is at minus 5 degree, and then you come here in your Cartesian, the current is at the angle of what? Minus 5. Okay, that's the current. Okay, and now it says what? Lagging. What is that lagging mean? Lagging, it mean the current is coming behind the voltage. The current is here. Okay, behind the voltage, which mean the current must be following it. So this guy, the voltage is in front, but the current is lagging it. It's coming behind it. The current is coming behind it. When you are rotating here like this, when you come, you can see that the current is coming behind the voltage. Okay, and the split difference between the two is how much? 15. What is that split? Is the power factor angle, or any other name they want to call it. So the difference in angle between the two is 15. Okay, so if you say minus 5 plus 15, then you're gonna have a voltage at the angle of 10. So this guy, the voltage is gonna be at 10. So when you come in our 1D dimension, it's gonna be minus 15 plus 15, then you have this guy, the voltage will be at the position of 10 meter, for instance. So that's how you play around with this phasor diagram. Reference, know if it's leading or lagging. 3, know the split difference between the two. So that power factor is always the split difference angle in angle between the two. So let's have a look on some example. as it says, they give us an instantaneous value of the voltage and the current through from the supplier at this power factor, and it says lagging. Already we know that with this voltage we need to change it to RMS value so that we have it in polar form, but remember the mistake here is what costs. So to change it to a sine, you add 90 degrees to it, okay? And therefore from our formula we know that the power factor, it's given by cos of our power factor angle, okay? So the power factor is given as 0.866. So in order to calculate the angle, you want to take the angle is going to be given by inverse cos of that power factor. So our power factor angle is going to be 30. So when you come to drawing your phasor diagram, what do you say? You have a reference. What is our reference? Is this. The current has a magnitude but is missing an angle. So you come here, you say the voltage, you put your your Cartesian, and you say your voltage is at angle of what? My voltage, my supplier voltage is at the angle of 16 degree. Okay. What did it say? It says lagging. What is that lagging mean? Lagging, it means the current is coming behind the voltage. Behind, it can be somewhere there. Just pick something imaginary. And then this 30 degrees is going to be the split angle between the two. So we're going to have 30. Okay. So if you say 116 minus 30, so our current is going to be at the angle of minus A of 86. Okay, so if you come here, you can say my current, the given current is gonna be 10 at the angle of 86. So that's how you do it, ampere. So you move from a magnet this form to a complex form using your phasor diagram. Another example, they say the supplier voltage, it's given. The supplier voltage is given as 380, and the current of 15 ampere is drawn from the supplier at a load angle of 30, and it says leading. So as you can see, if a voltage is given and there is not any angle given to it, you always take it at the angle of zero, okay? And then our power factor angle is 30. So how do we give an angle to this current? You need to draw a phasor diagram. So you come here, you put your Cartesian, then you say your voltage is at the angle of what? Zero, because that is our reference first point. We have it already, the first point. The second point, we need to know if it's leading or lagging, but they say leading. What is leading mean? Leading, it means the current is coming before the voltage. It means somewhere there. And then the third things, we need to know what is the split difference angle between the two, that the old load angle, and then it's gonna be 30. So if you take 0 plus 30, so you're gonna have a supplier current at the angle of what? Of 30 degree. So when you come here, you're gonna say your current is gonna be 15 at the angle of 30, because everything should be in a complex form. And then for the next video example, a current of 17 minus 15, it's given, that is drawn from the supplier, and the supplier is 330 at this power factor, okay, but they didn't specify if it's leading or lagging. Okay, but we change this power factor to an angle value by doing this. So our angle is going to be 30. Okay, so in order for us to draw our phasor diagram, because we are not happy with this voltage, okay, by the time they give us a voltage at a specific power factor, we are not going to give this voltage an angle of zero. We need to get the angle to it by drawing the phasor diagram. Okay, so how do you draw? You put your Cartesian. As you can see, the current is given at what? At angle of minus 16. So you come here, minus 16 can be somewhere there. Say my reference is the current because I know the position of that current. Okay, after doing that, now we need to check, is it leading or lagging? But when I read in my problem, I can see they didn't state anything about the power factor if it's leading or lagging. But you should be able, when you come in the circuit, you check, you see you have a combination of what? A resistor and a capacitor. With this case, we say what? The current always do what? Lead. So therefore, now you can see that in my circuit, because of this configuration, I'm gonna have a leading power factor. I'm gonna have a leading power factor because of the capacitive circuit. If it was an inductive circuit, it's gonna be lagging. Okay, so therefore our current will be somewhere there. Leading is gonna be before the voltage, and the split difference between the two is 30. Okay, so therefore if you say minus 16 plus 30, so our voltage is gonna be at the angle of 14. So when you come here, you can say you supply a voltage, it's gonna be given by 230. At the angle of 14. So remember, we save the power factor when you have to calculate it. We say what? It's going to be the angle of the voltage minus the angle of the current. The angle of the voltage is how much? 14, huh? Minus what? The angle of the current minus 16. And then we still going to get an angle of 30. Can you see how to calculate the power factor angle by knowing the angle of the voltage and the current? Active, reactive, and complex power. When it comes to active power, you have this triangle. When they ask you to draw a complex an impedance triangle, that's how you draw it. You put your resistor and your inductor and capacitor when you have a combination of what? Resistor, capacitor, and inductor. Okay, and then for the capacitive, this will be your impedance triangle. Okay, so when you're calculating our active power, this will be the formula we are going to use. The current time square over the times the resistor, or the most often used is this, the magnitude of the voltage times the magnitude of the current times the cos of the power factor angle. Okay, so let's look now. We have a active power due to the resistor. Can you see that? Due to the resistor, we have a active power. Due to the resistor, we have a active power. Okay, when it comes to the reactive power, we calculate it like that. The magnitude of the voltage times the magnitude of the current times sine of the power factor angle. The unit is var, volt, ampere, reactive. Okay, and then we're gonna have a reactive power. Okay, gonna have a reactive power due to the inductance. Gonna have a reactive power due to the capacitance. Okay, so and again we check for our complex power or apparent power, and to calculate it, as you can see, that mean conjugate. Okay, our complex power is going to be given by the voltage times the conjugate of the current. The conjugate of the current, what does that mean? Let's say our current is given as 15 at the angle of 10, for instance. So the conjugate of this current is going to be 15 at the angle of minus 10. Okay, so if it was negative, we make it positive. We just change the sign of our angle of the current. So that's what mean here, the conjugate of the current, and the unit is volt ampere. Okay, and therefore you're gonna have a reactive power due to the impedance. Reactive power due to the impedance. Okay, so the two triangle, the impedance triangle and the complex power, the two triangle must always be similar in the same circuit. Okay, so, but the thing now is, now we have a formation of this angle, which we say it's an impedance angle, complex power angle, power load angle, any other name that will be called. Can you see? So the bigger this angle will be, the bigger our power factor will be. And this angle, they are similar in both cases. Okay, the power factor is the same. Can you see? But let's look here. If our complex power is given in polar form, if you change it to rectangular form, okay, you're gonna have this real part is gonna be your active power. The imaginary part will be your reactive power, but it's gonna depend. If it says positive here, which means it's going to be QL. If it's negative, it's going to be QC. So that's it. When they ask you to draw the impedance angle, when they ask you to draw the complex triangle, that's how you draw it. So in the next video, now we start doing our calculation and move forward. But from now, I'm sure you should be able to understand already some of the example, even when you look at it yourself.